Okay, so Sandro Sozzo is Associate Professor at the University of Leicester School of Business, where he is also the Director of a Research Center for Quantum Social and Cognitive Science. He is the author of numerous high-impact publications with pioneering contribution in the development of novel models in cognitive psychology and application in decision-making under uncertainty and behavioral economics. I give the floor to Sandro, with pleasure, who will talk about the Quantum Cognition Research Program.
Thank you, Massimiliano. I think Massimiliano was just to come. I'm not sure. I really did what he mentioned.
Please speak to the microphone.
Sorry, but can you hear me?
Yeah.
So I think it's not necessary.
But the microphone for the streaming.
For the streaming.
This microphone is for the streaming. So make sure that you that hears.
I should be closer to that.
That circle that hears the world.
So I should be around this. Okay, very good. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this talk. And typically, one starts his talks by inviting by thanking the organizers for inviting him. And for giving this this opportunity, which of course I do. So many thanks for inviting me. But I'm in particular, I would like to thank you all for coming, because this is a truly interdisciplinary event. I have to admit, I have never been in a so interdisciplinary meeting with so many outstanding speakers from so broad variety of disciplines. So we are here scholars from mathematics, from physics, from biology, from psychology, economics, finance, computer science, and so on, political science, and so on. So, and I'm sorry if I forgot some disciplines. But so I'm very happy to have the opportunity to talk to you about the Quantum Cognition Research Program. Well, I should say the our contribution to the Quantum Cognition Research Program. So the results that we have obtained in a decade of research on the application of the mathematical formalism of quantum theory, let me anticipate this without any interpretation or physical connotation, to the modeling of cognitive phenomena that have resisted traditional modeling techniques by means of classical approach. And I will come back to this. So this is basically the focus of my talk. I will just anticipate something about a promising research domain. I will just devote one slide to the result that we had, the promising results that we have obtained recently on the application of the quantum formalism to the decision making under uncertainty with potential applications in economics and so on. And let me say, I would like to convince you, or at least to try to convince you, that this is potentially groundbreaking research. Okay? Just one thing. The Brussels group is a partner in a research consortium involving seven European universities. The research consortium has been called QUARTZ, Quantum Information Access and Retrieval Theory, which has been recently awarded a Marie Curie Advanced Training Network of the amount of 3.5 million euros. So there are great potentialities in this domain. And we are delighted to have here the coordinator of the project, who I don't see here, Massimo Melucci. I have not arrived yet. So, and he will talk about something more specifically about that. And another thing I've never done in my talks is presenting our research team. Because it's really a fantastic group of collaborators. It's a very good and balanced mixture between established scholars and young and talented collaborators. I personally have the honor and pleasure to work with Diederik Hartz, who was one of the pioneers in this domain, and also Yonito Argeles, who should have talked about a novel application of the quantum formalism to the mechanism of visual perception, and unfortunately they are both sick with flu, and so they could not participate in this event. But our collaborators are also Lester and Lynette Beltran, Suzette Guerriente, Catarina Moreira, who recently joined me at the School of Business of the University of Leicester, Massimiliano, who gave his fantastic talk just some minutes ago, and the main organizer of this event, Thomas Velloz, who did really, really a fantastic job. So let me start with a fact. So in 2002, Daniel Kahneman was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economic Science for having integrated insights from a psychological research into economic science, especially concerning human judgment and the decision making under uncertainty. So what we did, so the first thing that we did is we started investigating how we typically formalize human judgment and the decision making under uncertainty. Well, we typically use a set of theoretic structures that are similar, the same type of those typically employed in distributive logic, Boolean logic, and in the probability theory, that is the typical probability theory that we teach in our courses, that was formalized by Kolmogorov in the 30s. I will refer from now on to these structures as classical structures. And by the way, this is the name that is given to these structures by both physicists and the psychologists. They call them in the same way. What is probably less known is accumulating paradoxical findings in cognitive psychology reveal that these classical structures are generally unable to model concrete human decisions. And this makes problematical the interpretation of a whole set of cognitive phenomena in terms of Boolean logic and Kolmogorovian probability theory. In this respect, so the experimental psychology has identified two macro areas where you can find these empirical deviations from classicality. Probability judgment errors, so people judge the probability of the conjunction of two events is higher than the probability of one or even both them, so in this way violating the monotonicity law of Kolmogorovian probability, and you typically have a similar effect for this junction, and the decision-making errors. So people generally prefer to take an action A over an action B if they know that the given event Z occurs, and also if they know that Z does not occur, but they generally prefer B over A if they don't know whether Z occurs or not. And in this case, you have typically violation of the law of total probability. So examples of probability judgment errors are these two types, these two kinds. So over and under extension effects in membership judgments on conceptual community. Yes, please.
I have a question to the violation of total probability. What means A or B?
It's the conditional problem. It's the conditional. The conditional.
Yeah, B accent.
B prime, not B, the component. The component. Okay? So another example is conjunctive and disjunctive fallacies. I'm sure that some of you have heard about the Linda Story problem. While relevant examples of decision-making errors are given by the disjunction effect and more generally by the violations of some of the axioms of expected utility theory, and also we'll come back to this, like in Ellsberg-type paradoxes. So we wondered whether Kolmogorovian probability is the only way we have to talk about probabilities and events. And of course, the answer is not, because, for example, quantum probability formalizes uncertainty in the microscopic world, and we know that quantum probability does not obey the mathematical restrictions of Kolmogorovian probability. And so I would say that, so you see the difference. So in the former case, you have a normalized probability measure on a sigma algebra of sets, roughly speaking. In the latter case, you have a generalized probability measure over a more complex structure, so a lattice of projection operators over a Hilbert space. So, starting from the 90s, the application of the formalism of quantum theory has been successful to model these deviations from classicality in cognition and in social sciences. In this sense, I would say that our approach is, so the quantum cognition research program is alternative to the Tversky and Kahneman research program. According to Tversky and Kahneman, these deviations from classicality are real fallacies.
indeed, whence the name, effects, contradictions, paradoxes, and so on. So, and they proposed a theory which is well known to explain these deviations in terms of individual heuristics and biases. While, according to the quantum cognition research program, the empirical deviations from classicality are not due to biases. They just express genuine quantum structures in a human reasoning. I think that this sentence deserves some comments, and so I will come back to this. The University of Leicester was one of the first institutions to invest on this, I would say, flourishing research domain, and so I founded, together with my friend Emmanuel Haven, who is now in Canada, the Research Center for Quantum Social and Cognitive Science. So if you have a look at the website, you will find the activities that we run in our research center. Okay, a couple of warnings. Let me say, I was trained as a quantum physicist. But we don't do quantum physics. And we don't do quantum information. Okay? So we talk, we use the quantum structures as mathematical structures without any interpretation. Okay? So somebody else uses the term quantum-like structures, others use the term quantum mathematics, but this is what we are talking about, right? And it is important that, in particular, we do not presuppose any existence of microscopic quantum processes in the human brain. This approach is compatible with the quantum brain hypothesis, but it's not presupposed in our approach. We are agnostic with respect to this assumption because this is not required in the results that we obtain. But it's compatible with the quantum brain hypothesis. Okay, so then why going into quantum? Well, we observed that there is an interesting analogy between quantum and conceptual entities, like Massimiliano has said just some minutes before. So it's generally accepted also among psychologists that judgments create rather than record. In a sense, we know that in a quantum measurement process, the measurement context influences the measured quantum particle in a non-deterministic way, so actualizing properties that were potential prior to the measurement. Well, if we reflect on what generally occurs in a decision process, well, it generally involves a transition from potential to actual, in which one outcome is actualized as a consequence of a contextual interaction between the decision maker and the conceptual situation that is the object of the decision. Another possible way to say this is that judgments disturb each other, introducing uncertainty and order effects. So I would say that both quantum and conceptual entities are realms of genuine potentialities, not lack of knowledge of actualities. In this sense, probably it is better to use quantum probability, because we know that quantum probability copes in a good way with contextuality, pure potentiality, and indeterminism. But this was just the starting point. So we applied in these insights into concept research. So you see, understanding how concepts combine to form sentences and text and how meaning is expressed by using these combinations is a major challenge to cognitive psychology, and it has a lot of applications, from linguistics to philosophy to psychology to computer science, artificial intelligence, and so on. There is a very old view of concepts that probably can be traced back to Aristotle. It's called the classical view. So a concept, according to the classical view, can just be represented as a set of its instances. So which share a common number, a common features, okay, of necessary and sufficient defining properties. Well, it was Roche, the first, who experimentally challenged this view with her experiments on color in the 70s, I think. So concepts exhibit aspects of context dependence, vagueness, graded typicality. So the situation is more complex than just suggested by the classical view. So this is what inspired Zader in the 80s to suggest the fuzzy set representation of concepts.
So for each item X and for each concept A, we attach, we associate, we connect them by means of a graded membership, in such a way that the conjunction of two concepts satisfies the minimum rule of fuzzy set conjunction, while the disjunction satisfies the maximum rule of fuzzy set disjunction. But a whole set of experiments challenged also this fuzzy set representation concept. The first was suggested by Oscherson and Smith, and is known as the Duppi effect. So people judge an exemplar like Duppi to be a very typical example of the conjunction pet fish, without judging Duppi to be a typical example of either pet or fish. Duppi, I would say, also goldfish could have the same properties. And another set of experiments are the experiments which Massimiliano was talking about this, right? So it was about Anton's experiments. So people judge the membership weight of the conjunction of two concepts to be higher than the membership weight of one or both component concepts over extension. And we have a symmetric effect for the disjunction where you have under extension. And borderline contradictions, which is a particular case of these, were for sentences like A and not A. So this raises the combination problem, how we represent the combination of two concepts in terms of the representation of the component concepts. Okay, so as I was saying, we were trained as quantum physicists. In particular, we have worked for a year in the axiomatic foundations of quantum physics. So in the 70s in particular, this was a really big issue of quantum theory. How we can reconstruct the Hilbert space formalism of quantum physics from physically justified axioms? How can we reconstruct it? And it can be reconstructed from physically justified axioms resting on well-defined empirical notions more directly connected with the operations that we typically perform in a laboratory. And one of the major approaches to this is the approach of the Geneva-Brussels realistic operational approach to the foundations of quantum physics. So any physical entity can be described in terms of basic notions, operationally defined, state, context, and property. So this mathematically constitutes a scope system. If you impose suitable axioms, physically justified axioms, to the scope system, you get up to isomorphism in a unique way the Hilbert space structure of quantum physics as a theory. So we think to have been able to provide a similar realistic and operational foundations, but for conceptual entities. So in which each conceptual entity is defined in terms of its states, context, properties, measurements, and outcome probabilities. Here I tried to provide this, of course, as we were saying, the situation is not so easy to understand like in microscopic physics, but cognitive experiments are performed in a psychological laboratory, a space-temporal domain, like physical laboratory, physics. So the context of experimental procedures conceived by the experimenter, the experimental design and setting, and the cognitive effect that one intends to investigate define a conceptual entity A, which is assumed to be prepared in a specific state PA. A context is something external to the conceptual entity that can influence the entity and potentially change its state. So typicality and membership become measurable quantities with different values for different states of the concept. So the real bold element in this approach is the fact that the concept is not anymore a set. It becomes an entity that is in a given state and whose state can change. So in this way, we were able to do a lot of nice things. So we worked out a quantum representation for the data collected on pet fish and or the conjunction. We elaborated a quantum theoretic model in Fock space, which is it's a Hilbert space that is used when we have more concepts that combine.
which allowed us to represent membership weight data explaining over and under extension in terms of genuine quantum effects. In this case, the quantum effects were contextuality, emergence, interference, superposition. We applied this system to borderline contradictions. We extended to negation, identifying new non-classical effects in addition to those identified by Hampton. As Massimiliano was anticipating in his previous talk, we were able to identify violation of Bell's inequalities in a specific conceptual combination. We identified quantum type, indistinguishability of Bose-Einstein type in conceptual combinations, and so on. Here, what I would like to do is to give you the simplest model we can elaborate. And this very simple model is enough to model lots of cognitive effects, providing also new predictions. So, Hampton's experiment. James Hampton is an experimental psychologist at the City University of London. So he considered this experiment. So take some items, apple, broccoli, olive, coconut, almond, and so on. So consider a pair of natural concepts, like fruits, vegetables. Take their conjunction, fruits and vegetables, and their disjunction, fruits or vegetables. Then ask participants in an experiment, by means of a questionnaire, to rate the membership of these items with respect to fruits, with respect to vegetables, for example, with respect to their disjunction. This is very typical in psychology. You can do this on a Likert scale. In this case, it's a 7-point Likert scale. Then you take the relative frequencies of positive answers, you convert them into probabilities of membership. This is what psychologists call membership weights. Well, he did this systematically for several items and different pairs of concepts. What we found, analyzing Hampton's data, is that their data on the conjunction of his data for the conjunction of two concepts cannot be represented in a single Kolmogorovian probability space. Because for the data mu A, mu B, and mu A and B, you can find the necessary and sufficient conditions for representativity in a classic probability space, in a Kolmogorovian one. These are the two conditions. I just took an example, a razor, which is has nice properties because it's double overextended, you see? Its membership weight with respect to two weapons and its membership weight with respect to tools are both less than its membership weight with respect to their conjunction, you see? So you have that the first two conditions is satisfied, which is the one that violates monotonicity. The monotonicity law. So, you can find the same thing for the disjunction. I don't bother you with this, but it's the same story. You can find the necessary and sufficient conditions for representing data on the disjunction, and you see that for a whole set of examples. Ashtray is an item, you see. Ashtray is the one that you were wearing this morning. And so if you take its membership weight of ashtray, you see that it's double underextended. So classical set theoretic logic and probabilistic structures seem to be too limited to represent even simple combinations of two concepts. And here our approach comes. So this is our construction, the quantum theoretical construction. Let's start for the disjunction. Take an item X, take two concepts, A and B, their conjunction, A and B, then the corresponding membership weights, mu A, mu B, mu A and B. Then take a Hilbert space to represent conceptual entities, represent A by means of a unit vector of the Hilbert space, and B by means of a unit vector of the same Hilbert space. Assume this is a technical assumption, that A and B are orthogonal. And this is the new element. We represent A and B by the linear combination with the equal weights of A plus B. This is the new element in the approach. The decision measurement of a person, it is a measurement with two outcomes, either yes or no. So, in a quantum-like style, it can be represented by an orthogonal projection operator over the Hilbert space, H.
Okay, you just need to apply the Born rule of quantum probability. Mu A is this scalar product, mu B is this scalar product.
If you express mu A and B, you immediately find this term, which most of you will recognize be the typical interference term that you find in the quantum double slit experiment. The next thing is just some mathematical details. So the quantum probability formula for the conjunction of two concepts can be written in this way. So you see that an interference angle for the conjunction appears here, like this is something that was expected in this construction. And in particular, a specific solution, so you can show that the simplest Hilbert space that does the job is C3, the set of triples, the Hilbert space of triples of complex numbers. And you can represent the here the two concepts and their the interference term. So if you take, for example, a razor, these are the experimental data, so the model is solved for an interference angle of 64 degrees. Here you have constructive interference. So this is the representation of the concepts, so weapons and tools. So you can do the same for the disjunction of two concepts. I will not repeat the construction. You see that the disjunction A or B is represented again by the linear combination. What makes the conjunction case from the disjunction case different is the fact that the interference angle is different, the interference angle for the disjunction. Okay, so I just report the modeling of the experimental data that I considered previously as an example. So ashtray, the model is solved in C3 for this choice of the interference angle for the disjunction. Let me say that these quantum probability formulas work for a lot of Hamilton's data on the conjunction and the disjunction of two concepts.
What is interesting is that if you consider different... I forgot that there is this important step.
We did an experiment ourselves, so we generalized Hampton's experiment, extending them to conjunctions and negations of two natural concepts. So we tested in an experiment membership weights of items with respect to pairs of natural concepts, their negation, and all possible conjunctions. You see A and B, A and not B, not A and B, not A and not B. So it was a more complete experiment than the one you did.
Why A or B is not there in this list?
Because it was a nightmare analyzing the data. And I know that some of you were participants in the experiment. And after the experiment, was telling me that that it was a really complete experiment. Of course, we could have done this, and we expect to do this.
Why I say the Boolean algebra says that each relation between variables is a combination of and, or, and not.
Is it not possible to represent it just in terms of two, to express the disjunction in terms of the other two? Not sure, because there are the Morgan's laws.
And, or, and not.
Not A, O, B, O, B.
But in any case, we wanted to test the Morgan's laws, but we have not done it. So systematic double overextension, we found a systematic double overextension in all conjunctions, A and B, A and not B, not A and B, and not A and not B. This was expected. We found deviations from classicality in the conceptual negation, another thing that was expected. But completely unexpected was this new non-classical effect we discovered. So we identified a systematic and a significant deviation from classicality in the marginal law. This number, according to a classical model, should be zero for all examples. We We found that this is not zero, of course, we expect, but this number oscillates around 0.5 independently of the item and independently of the pair of concepts that we consider. It's a constant. And you can do a statistical analysis on this. You find that it's a constant. Our quantum model for the conjunction and the negation exactly predicts this value, 0.5. So this means that these models are predictive. You can find new classical effects that were not expected by just analyzing overextension and underextension. And we tried to formulate an explanatory hypothesis for what was going on there.
Excuse me, can you show the 0.5 where it comes from, the theory?
The 0.5?
Yes. Because this is a crucial point of the argument.
Of course. Let me say that it comes more or less from this fact. If you go to the conjunction, you see? And you sum all them. You have that some pieces simplify, and so finally what you get is a number that is 0.5, assuming that there is only that there are some technicalities involved. If you wish, I can explain to you privately this, but you can find it, and it's published, so it's public.
No adjustable parameter.
No. It's parameter free. This test. It's parameter free. So, okay, so this is the explanatory hypothesis. Whenever a person estimates the membership of, let's say, olive with respect to fruits or vegetables, the person does not really wonder whether olive is a fruit, is a vegetable, and then applies logical reduced down in a probabilistic setting, of course. But in particular, for some specific examples, and olive is one of them, the person really wonders whether olive is a member of a new emergent concept, considered in its unitarity, which is fruits or vegetables. So in these cases, we have an effect of conceptual emergence. Of course, this does not occur with apple. But for some examples, in particular, when the person starts wondering whether olive is a fruit or doubting whether olive is a fruit or a vegetable, the person actually does this. This is what can be extracted from our modeling. So there is the appearance of an emergent reasoning which plays a role across other cognitive effects which have, in principle, nothing to do with concept theory. For example, Tversky and Kahneman, this conjunction fallacy. So Tversky and Kahneman identified the conjunction fallacy through this story about a liberal woman named Linda. So we know that Linda is 31 years old, she is single, outspoken and very bright. She majored in philosophy. As a student, she was deeply concerned with the issues of discrimination and social justice, and also participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations. Then the participants were asked to check which of the two alternatives was more probable. Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement. First, Kahneman found that overall 85% of the participants indicated that 2 is more likely than 1. So the conjunction fallacy clearly violates monotonicity, or the monotonicity law of quantum probability. And this is not the only effect identified by Tversky and Kahneman. There is a large empirical literature on confirming the conjunction fallacy. And you can find also several attempts at explaining this. I just reported, I'm not an expert in the history of how the attempts of explaining this. Well, one of the possible solutions was elaborated by Tversky and Kahneman themselves, so the reasoning bias hypothesis, so the judgment heuristic of representativeness. There is the misunderstanding hypothesis as well, and there is also an alternative explanation which is becoming more and more accepted, that was elaborated by my friends Emmanuel Potos and Jerome Busemeyer in 2006, in terms of question order effects. The questions are incompatible in the quantum sense, and so you can find order effects. And they elaborated the quantum model exactly to explain, to first to model and then to explain the fallacy. Well, there are others, but let me just focus on this experiment. A more complete experiment was performed by Morier and Borgida in 1984. So people were asked to rank the likelihood of the following events. Linda is a feminist, Linda is a bank teller, Linda is a feminist and a bank teller, Linda is feminist or a And these authors found two effects. They found overextension in the conjunction, so a conjunction fallacy, and they also found underextension in the disjunction, so a disjunction fallacy. So, in our case, we can translate the quantum model for the conjunction of two concepts in terms of the conjunction fallacy, interpreting it as an effect of overextension. We have mu A, 0.83, mu B, 0.26, the conjunction 0.36. We apply the same machinery, just the same model with different data. And you find that the model works for an interference angle of 121 degrees. So you have disruptive interference here. The interesting thing, and this makes a difference with respect to the quantum model of Grossemeyer and Photos, is that our model predicts a double conjunction fallacy. So a situation where this number is bigger than both two of them. Here we have a single overextension. See? It predicts also double, but less likely than the single cases. And this seems to be the case from the analysis. Where is Thomas? Thomas analyzed an incredible a big data set. The model worked for all the data, and the double disjunct conjunction fallacies were really less likely, though they existed. And the same we can do for the disjunction fallacy. So we use the quantum model for the disjunction of two concepts. It's again the same machinery, and the model works for an interference angle of 81 degrees. Also here, we expect also the presence of double disjunction fallacies. Again, now less likely than a single disjunction fallacies. How much time do we have? 5? Yeah, okay, very good. Another effect, which is not a probability judgment error, but overextension, underextension of membership weights, the conjunction and disjunction fallacies, are effects of probability judgment errors. While this, the disjunction effect, is an effect of, is a decision-making error, because it violates the sure-thing principle, which is one of the key axioms of expected utility theory. So, the modern theory of choice under uncertainty. So this is the story that inspired Savage when formulating the sure-thing principle. The, roughly speaking, the idea is the following. If you prefer A over B when you know that an event occurs, and if you prefer A over B when you know that the event does not occur, you should prefer A over B also when you don't know the outcome of the event, whether the event occurs or not. And the disjunction effect was tested by Tversky and Shafir in 1992 in two experiments, the two-stage gamble and the away problem. And in both cases, you had that the sure-thing principle was violated. If you translate this into probabilistic terms, you find that it's the law of total probability that is violated in the disjunction effect. And there is an explanation that was given by Tversky and Shafir for this disjunction effect. People prefer sure over unsure choices. This is the uncertainty. In our case, the disjunction effect can be explained in terms of, again, double underextension. It's the same model, and it works for both the sure-thing, for both the two-stage gamble and the away problem. So, what did we do in these 30 minutes? Well, we presented a unitary quantum theoretic model for a set of effects across different cognitive and social science domains. And we tried to formulate an explanatory hypothesis for the observed deviations from classical logical reasoning in cognition. In this hypothesis, in this human reasoning, is a specifically structured superposition of two simultaneous processes. We have, yes, a logical reasoning, combining conceptual entities by applying the rules of logic, of course, in a generally probabilistic way, because of the fuzziness that we have found before. But there is also an emergent reasoning enabling the formation of conceptual entities as newly emerging entities, carrying new meaning. The abundance of effects, fallacies, contradictions, and so on suggested us that probably what has been called a fallacy is not a real fallacy, but is a consequence of the dominant dynamics and its nature is emergence, is the consequence of this part of reasoning. While what has been considered as a default to deviate from is a consequence of a secondary form of dynamics. I have just one slide. So, as promised before, there is something interesting that is coming out from the application of this quantum theoretical modeling to decision-making under uncertainty. I anticipated this before, so expected utility theory is the predominant model of choice under uncertainty. And according to expected utility theory, people should take decisions as if they maximized their expected utility with respect to a Kolmogorovian probability measure, which is typically interpreted as formalizing their uncertainty. Well, we know that concrete situations exist in which human decisions concretely violate the predictions of expected utility theory. This was, for example, found by Ellsberg in 1961, which reveals that the psychological aspects, like, for example, uncertainty aversion, drive in a subtle way human decisions, so the way in which people concretely take decisions. Well, in the quantum theoretic framework, people actually take decisions by maximizing their expected utility theory with respect to a quantum probability measure, incorporating the psychological aspects above. So you see, this is what they should do. This is how they concretely behave. The theoretic framework is flexible enough to reproduce different experimental patterns arising from different attitudes toward uncertainty, which suggests going toward a quantum-based, state-dependent extension of expected utility theory. Let me clarify. We are trying to model what people concretely do, not what people should do. Okay? In this sense, the approach is not normative, but I would say it is descriptive. Just to say that these are the publications, and you see that there are, it's hard to find physical journals there, so there are publications in economic papers, computer science papers, philosophical papers, biological papers, and so on. Just to answer the question about where to find the technical details, you find them here in this publication. Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. Thank you for your attention.
I mean it's for the best.
Francis.
I quite like your very elegant use of the term of parameters measuring the interference effect, but I see a big problem there, which is that you actually have to explain one deviation, and for each deviation you can set the parameter, which means basically that you could set the parameter and it will always work.
No, not always. This is a good question, and indeed, typically, this is the first question psychologists ask. It's true that you have a new parameter here, and of course, there is a difference between what occurs in physics, where the parameter actually is the angle, the interference angle, and you can see this geometrically. Here you don't take it, at least you don't take the idea of a quantum brain where there is something occurring in the human mind, so these angles has to do with the spatial structure of the brain. I don't insist on this point. You have a new parameter. Let me also say that this does not work for all set of experimental data on A, new B, new A, new B. Okay? So there are general, I would say, epistemological reasons when you should apply the quantum model. And this model is not a bug in the sense that you don't, as you see, you don't have the model and the you create a new model for a new set of data.
it's the same instruction that comes from investigating quantum theory as a general theory to model cognitive phenomena. So this comes, this structure is to satisfy the structural conditions and boundaries coming from using quantum theory as a unit. Okay, so in this sense, now you have a new parameter. I would not say that the model is wrong. This notwithstanding that you have predictions that are not parameter free. Sorry, that are parameter free, so they don't depend on the parameter.
Have you made predictions?
Yeah, it's the one in the experiment for conjunction manipulation, which was I had not been made before, because the old idea was, okay, we have an over extension and under extension, and psychologists and mathematicians already find problems in modeling this type of situation. Sorry? Yes, please.
Yes, so I find very stimulating the interpretation of the quantum component as not an error, but an emergent conceptualization, right? That's a strong message. But then I have a difficulty, I would like you to enlighten me with the following empirical fact, that when people make these non-standard decisions, they are allowed, for example, to consult with others, to train, to revisit a decision, they converge to the logical pure interpretation. So you could say in this way that when you mentioned that the non-logical component is an emergent new conceptualization and so on, is actually shown to be an error that they can correct through iterations, through social interaction, through having the possibility to learn. So how do you reconcile the two interpretations?
I have to say that I'm not sure, because, for example, let's
say
the conjunction
see what I mean? Fallacy. You see what I mean? You see
I'm not sure, but I'm trying to clarify this to myself. So I'm saying something that, see whether it converges to your question. If you take the conjunction fallacy, you identify the fallacy independently of the mathematical probabilistic background of people. And also if you explain the fallacy to the person, this has been done, so there is a huge literature to do this. It's independent of the mathematical background, so people commit these.
Yeah, but if they are trained, if they are explained, they will not commit it. You can actually account that, and we deliver the theory, as a decoherence effect. So and there's clearly a learning process. So that's I'm just asking and casting some question about this idea of emergence. I would like to, it's a nice idea, I think. I don't want to criticize it, but I have a difficulty to combine the empirical evidence that shows learning.
I need to check the experiment. Let me also say that, for example, I know that the fallacy is committed also when, because there is this misunderstanding hypothesis. No, people don't misunderstand that they misunderstand the concept end and the term of probability there, but you can find the fallacy also if you. So there is in some way a systematicity that at least in the first instance lead you to explain this in terms of emergence. Okay? And then I'm not saying that all emergence is the only thing that plays a role. You have also the logical aspect that plays a role. We think that at the first stage, when let me say in the context of discovery, it's emergence that plays a role. When you in the context of justification, rational reconstruction, learning process, for example, then I expect that logical reconstruction will play a more fundamental role. That is the second stage, and works at meta level.
Maybe we could say not emergent, but it's maybe evolutionary adaptive trait to explore widely new solutions that are not rational.
Which is the discovery, no?
Which
the
is
discovery.
So that could be one way of design, where you actually learn to go to the logical conclusion when the environment is stable and the discovery is not necessary.
Sure.
That could be one way of
designing. Yes. Did we converge?
Yeah. Last question there.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. I like very much this topic, and I think that basically it would be just the tip of a big island, because I think that the kind of argument you can attack by using this kind of approach I'm making. And what I ask you is just a kind of, I think, as a natural continuation of this work. Well, I think that the kind of problem you can also attach is the problem of bias. That is a very, very important problem in the actual philosophy of language. In the sense that basically, in this framework, you have associated the concept to a pure state. And this pure state is basically very often very, very clear concept for for a common human people, like you said, vegetable, fruit, and so on. Well, I think that a very natural way to continue the work that could be just associated, that we just consider some kind of pattern, some concept, something like big city, for instance, just replace the same problem, the same experiment, by considering this, and maybe it's just an idea, by associating to a concept, no more a new state, but maybe an ancient operator, whose linear entropy, that is, let me say, the quantity of the information, that would be in a certain sense proportional to the vagueness of the concept. My question is, if you have thought something about this, and what do you think about the possibility to attack the problem vagueness with your approach?
Yeah. Yeah, well, this is quite interesting, and indeed we have reflected about this possibility. There is something that is related to our training as quantum foundationists, you know? So our idea was that, okay, so the quantumness is in the pure states, because when you have density states, you just are adding a classical probability measure, which you can interpret in terms of ignorance. You can give an ignorance interpretation. So we thought that the main problems of quantum theory cannot be solved by coming from pure states and considering the density states. Of course, when you go into terms of entanglement and improper mixtures and you trace over degrees of freedom, then mixed states play again a big role. But this idea that you cannot find so many new things prevented us from investigating this deeply. But this is indeed a good suggestion, and I think that before or later we should start also thinking about that.
Thank you, Sandro.